Hi everyone, welcome to Perspective Podcast. My name is Finn.
My name is Ella.
My name is Kevin.
And welcome to our first episode of Perspective Podcast. So, to give you guys a bit of introduction of how we came up with this podcast was, we were doing a project where we were supposed to choose a social justice issue. And when the three of us were looking at all of these issues, we felt a lot of hopelessness because these were really, really big issues and we had no clue where to start when tackling all of these issues. So we were thinking, instead of taking one and sort of just doing it ourselves, why don't we take multiple issues and show teens and people in our community how everyone can take action to make meaningful change within the topics?
Yeah, I really wanted to, you know, well, especially given the sense of, like, disempowerment many youth feel when confronting, like, large social justice issues, we sort of decided that we should create a podcast that gives a platform for, you know, ourselves and local activists as well to discuss social justice issues and provide insight on those said issues.
Before we begin this episode of Perspective Podcast, we would like to acknowledge that we live, work, and play on the traditional unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh Coast Salish nations.
Today's episode focuses on women and feminism, and specifically how women are portrayed in relation to different forms of media. For that, we have a special guest here to tell us a little bit more about it.
Yeah, so our special guest today, who's going to be discussing some topics of women in the media and feminism with us, is Jules Kyi, who is a feminist, a student, and an author. And next year for university, she's going to study gender and sexuality studies and political sciences in the Sciences Po program. So Julia, you can introduce yourself.
Hi, thank you so much for having me today. I'm excited to talk with you all.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're so excited to have you today. Okay, so Julia, can you tell us a little bit about how you got into the realm of feminism and where that journey has led you to now?
Sure. So, I don't know, I've always been a bit of an SJW, as it were, but I think I really learned about feminism in kind of grade 9, 10, so it wasn't all that long ago. I was very inspired in like early grade 10 when I heard a podcast by Mona El-Tahawe, who is an Egyptian feminist that I love. And that was at the same time that I just received an 8-page letter from one of my best guy friends by email about how all women are liars. And so was like a compounding whirlwind for me.
We will get back to that later.
So that kind of took me down the journey of feminism. I started learning more about intersectionality. For those of you who aren't familiar with the term, intersectionality is acknowledging how different forms of oppression intersect and acknowledging that everyone experiences the world and experiences, in this case, feminism differently based on those intersections. And from there, I started writing. I wrote this book, Better Connected, about girls on social media. And then last year, I started working with Girls Learn International and leading Feminism Club and teaching about feminism for my Social Justice 12 project in the Lower Mainland. And I think it definitely opened a lot of doors for me. I want to study it just so I can say I have a degree in feminism. So yeah, it's been an interesting journey.
That's so cool.
Yeah, and that's so amazing. And I think it really goes to show that if you are someone who's interested in feminism, like Julia said, she just started really getting into this, what was it, a few years ago?
Yeah.
It's never too late, or it's never impossible to start learning about something and really put action to that.
Yeah, no, for sure.
Julia is an author, and she recently, or soon, she has a book being published called Better Connected, which highlights how girls are using social media for good. All three of us, Julia, we read through your book, and
it's really good.
Yeah.
It's very cool.
We all loved it, because especially, I think it's so nice to have a fresh perspective on such a prevalent issue within our community, and it's an issue that isn't really highlighted, because it's so normalized that when we're talking about social media and how girls are using the media, we always just see negative things, at least for me personally.
Yeah, no.
That's always what I've seen. So reading through your book, it was really, really nice to have this new way. It was very empowering to see how there's different ways that we can actually use social media and highlighting the girls that are using social media in a good way and making change.
Yeah. I don't know. I guess it was presented so well and, like, just in such a nice way that it makes you really want to, like, continue reading, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I feel so validated.
I don't know. I especially the hashtag no filter. I don't know. I found these really fun. These are such like a good addition to the book, in my opinion.
Yeah, because it didn't feel like a traditional textbook where it's like saying, oh, here is all the facts. It was a good balance of that, but also it was funny and it kept you reading.
Yeah.
So you wrote this book with your mom, correct? Do you want to tell us a bit about the experience in writing this book and sort of how that whole process went for you?
Sure. So my mom and I started writing this book at the beginning of the pandemic when we were both super bored. And my mom is quite an established nonfiction author, and she said she wanted to write a book about social media. And my mom is not that good at social media, and so I wanted to do it with her so that she didn't get it wrong, basically. So we started writing this book. I think, like Ella said, what I saw primarily when I was learning about social media and when I was younger is you got such a negative perspective on what it was going to be. Like, my main social media lesson I got from school over and over was just don't send nudes, and that's all you get. So I wanted to provide a perspective for girls who are maybe in that same kind of stage where they're about to enter the online world, so to show how social media can be harnessed as more of a powerful tool rather than just the shallow platforms that it's viewed as sometimes.
Right. Yeah, no, I'm sure, like, that's the same experience for us as well, especially on social media talks at school and all stuff like that. It's all very, you know, one-sided. So especially having a book like this where, like, even reading through it, it just feels like you're listening to, like, a conversation between you and your mother, like, with the different parts of it and the stories. It was, like, it was a really good perspective to have, I guess.
Thank you. It was funny writing it with her because we're so different. Like, just writing the book, she would write early in the morning on Word, and then I would write my parts late at night on Google Docs, and then we had to fuse it all together at the end.
Yeah, I think when it comes to social media and how women are portrayed in the media is so much more multifaceted than what we're taught. So there's obviously such a great side to it as well, but I also think that there's a lot of things that we see within social media that can be projected into how women are treated and stereotyped in real life. For example, I love how right at the start you were talking and exploring the double standards when it comes to social media, because it's something that's really, really present in, like, every single day when you go on social media. But it's so overlooked because it's so normalized. Like, for example, all the time I'll see a photo of a woman posting herself in, like, a bikini where she's confident and happy in her body, and then everyone is saying that she's, like, narcissistic or self-obsessed or vain. But then maybe a guy posts a photo showing off his body and he's, like, a boss and he's so cool and he's doing so well. And the same thing happens about, like, anything almost that a woman does. You can never really do anything right, because I remember a lot of people at around the time where the BLM movement was very
prominent.
A lot of people were posting on their stories, reposting, like, infographics and ways to help. And then when a girl is outspoken on her opinions on social media or assertive, she's, like, controlling or uptight or too, like, kind of like a bitch. But when a guy is saying his opinions and being assertive, he's so respectable and well-spoken. And these things happen all the time, but there's nothing to be done about it because it's so normalized. And I love that you explored that in your book. I think it's really interesting.
Thank you. Yeah, it was definitely interesting to kind of explore those double standards more. I think in this book, because it's a middle grade book, we didn't go too in-depth with them because of the age range that we're trying to target. But definitely researching those really opened my eyes to how like screwed up all of this misogyny is. And I was really seeing how it's so strange to me, like when you say when a girl posts something like a bikini photo or something like that, she is criticized by the same people who are consuming that media.
Mm-hmm.
Like the same men that are seeking out these photos are the ones who are critiquing the people making it. It's mm-hmm. just, it's very disheartening to see.
Yeah.
I found it particularly nice that you discussed gaming and video games in your book as well, because I think that is something that is criminally underlooked in many of these books about media. Because they tend to focus on movies and representation in movies, but gaming is an important part as well. There's a lot of serious problems with sexism in chats.
Yeah.
Representation in the games themselves.
Yeah, no, for sure. As, I don't know, I consider myself a pretty active gamer, quote unquote.
Beat Saber gamer.
Really felt that was necessary to
keep
say.
Keep going.
But yeah, in my experience, there's certainly, especially nowadays when the gaming, like, I guess, the people, the groups, people who play games, there's a word, demographic.
Mm-hmm.
The demographic is, like, it's changing. It's like, there's more and more female gamers every day. I think it's definitely much more of an issue that needs to be addressed. Everything, just so much hate speech in some gaming communities, especially, like, the shooter ones, which are more male-dominated sort of communities. There's just so much, like, harassment that goes on in, like, the voice chats that you can just join at random, whatever, you're just joining a random game. It's very, like, it's sad to see.
Yeah, I remember when I used to play Brawl Stars. Thank God that phase is over, but I used to play that game quite a bit, like, during the pandemic, and I remember all the time I would, like, join a team with some random, like, 14-year-old guys, and they would immediately be talking about me, like, oh yeah, that guy did whatever, and obviously I'm gonna correct them, so I said, oh, I'm actually a girl. Literally 100% of the times that would happen, for some reason they don't believe me. They would say, no, you're not. And I'm sitting there, like, behind my phone, like,
oh yeah, my bad.
Yeah, oh yeah, sorry. Yeah.
You're right.
I forgot, please forgive me. I would tell them I'm a girl. They would say, no, you're not, that's not possible. Girls shouldn't play this game. Someone told me that girls shouldn't play this game. And it's really sad because, of course, that doesn't get to me, because I feel like when you've been exposed to it, you're sort of aware how wrong it is, but you think about how this affects, like, younger girls and girls that maybe haven't been educated about stuff like this, that they're being told to their face, you can't do this. And it's so prevalent in the gaming community, but it's prevalent everywhere that you can see, and
yeah.
That's just... It, like, we laugh about it because it's funny that some random guys are telling me I'm not a girl, but
in reality, it's so, like,
it's so harmful.
Damn. Yeah,
it's like, Julia, from through researching this book and just from your experience, do you think there's any ways that all of us can not, well, I guess specifically for the gaming community, but when we see stuff like that happening, what can we do to sort of make a change?
I think just being present in these communities is a step in itself, like, as you're doing, Ella, by being there, and you're a form of representation in yourself, I suppose.
Yeah.
In these kind of situations, it's honestly, it's just very frustrating. I think hopefully things will begin to fade as more people are held accountable and more people are called out, and there is more continual representation in communities like gaming and in media as a whole. I think it's also important to hold these game makers accountable for the representation they're putting out,
mm-hmm.
for the how they sexualize female characters,
yeah.
or how they don't put in any female characters at all.
Yeah.
And I think having that positive representation within the games would hopefully help to slowly
mm-hmm.
transfer to the world outside of that as well. But it's definitely a tricky thing.
Yeah, I think that on the note of holding people accountable, I think that is so important, because sometimes when you see something like that happening, one of the most important things that you can do especially if, not only if, but especially if you're friends with that person, is not just like letting it slide because you guys are friends. Like,
right.
Everyone being educated will kind of create a domino effect where you hold other people accountable and sort of educate them, because I think that a lot of these negative or harmful comments just come from not being educated or just not knowing enough about the subject, and therefore you think that something like that would be okay. Obviously that's not always the case, but it is a lot of the time like that. So simply by like holding accountable and education, I think that's already something that literally anyone can do when it comes to stuff like this.
Yeah, I think just accountability is sort of a thing we need to focus on, because I think as accountability, that's what's mostly, I'd say probably, sorry, I'm using a lot of mostly probablys, but that's what could inflict a big change. Because if we all hold each other accountable, that's, then something's gotta change, right?
Definitely. I think the, like, difference between accountability and cancel culture is also important in this current day and age. I think that's a big thing with social media, and a big thing I saw researching this book is we literally had to take several people out because they kept getting canceled.
Oh, yeah.
And then you have to take them out because
yeah.
you don't want to be taken down with that, I guess. But I think it's really, it's a tricky time to be a young person learning and growing on social media. And it is a tricky balance as well consuming that content, because when someone makes a mistake or they say something wrong, you do want to hold them accountable, certainly. But I think that that's also performative if you're not giving them any room to grow in the future. At the same time, I don't think it should be the responsibility of any marginalized groups to educate or to inform on things like that. It should be that whoever made this mistake here is taking the time to re-educate themselves, to seek out that information, and to hopefully learn and grow from that. And then I would hope that we would be able to provide them that space to grow and to return more educated, rather than just completely banishing
yeah.
them from social
yeah.
media.
Right.
I think that's something that we see a lot, that not only when it comes to feminism and women speaking up for them for their own rights, like any marginalized group having to defend themselves and constantly explain themselves, and they need to take on the role of educator to the uneducated person who has already done some sort of harm, which isn't fair in any way. So if we are all together working towards this communal goal of knowledge and education and acceptance, it's much more, not just fair, but it's more effective that way than having, because it feels so bad to always be having to defend yourself and explain yourself in these situations, like as a woman or someone as part of a marginalized group. And yeah, I think it's so interesting that we're discussing cancel culture, because that's really something I wanted to touch on when we're talking
yeah.
about social media. It's such a sort of, there's so many different angles to cancel culture.
Did you mention it in your book?
Yes, we do have a bit about cancel culture. When we were writing that book, it was like right at the time when the D'Amelios were getting canceled for
yeah.
like the snail or
oh,
some
yeah.
shit like
yeah.
that.
Eating escargot. That was so interesting
it was,
to read about.
For
I haven't
anyone,
heard about that at all.
For anyone that's listening and doesn't know what we're talking about, I remember, I can't remember the exact details, but it was the most strange thing. There was a YouTube video of the D'Amelio family, who are like TikTokers.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them, was it Dixie?
Dixie
yeah.
She was acting like she didn't want to eat a snail. I wouldn't want to eat a snail either. And then she threw it up on, like, she went away and threw it up. And then everybody, there was immense backlash for
yeah.
something literally as not liking snail.
Food preference.
Food preference, basically, where everybody canceled her for being rude and impolite and... That's really interesting, because I wonder if Dixie was a man, if it would have gotten the same response, because everyone was saying
mm-hmm.
she's not being ladylike, she should have, like, thanked the chef and just, like, sucked it up and ate the snail, like, it's so rude to do something like that. And it's so interesting, because so much attention was given to this call out of Dixie for throwing up a snail that could have taken away the attention from so many other actually important cancels or call-outs that were happening at the time that no one probably even knew about because everyone was focusing on Dixie doesn't like snail.
And that's what the media does, right? It's like, it pulls attention away from things.
The thing with cancel culture is one of its big problems is you have situations like this Dixie incident where there's cancel culture and then critics point to it and be like, whoa, whoa, whoa. This is stupid. They're going at everyone in the cancel cultures, and then you generalize and say that, oh, they're only going over frivolous things. I don't know why I did frivolous, whatever. And they can criticize the whole movement as a whole, which detracts from, as you were saying, the legitimate cancellations of people who have committed serious wrongs.
Right.
That is a big problem in cancel culture, I guess.
Yeah, and I was going to ask Julia,
do you have your background noise cancellation, like, on high? That might be why.
Oh,
so
you didn't noise suppression.
You know,
where,
the show.
It's in settings.
Okay, wait.
Voice and video, drag the window over. Yeah, voice and video. Oh, scroll down.
Oh, gosh.
Scroll down. Ah, turn off noise suppression. That might be it.
Oh, okay. Wait.
Kevin, can you hear us now? Kevin,
hello.
Why did he just have three strokes? Kevin, we're each gonna say something. Put your thumb up while you can hear us. Hello, Kevin.
Kevin, can you hear me? Hello, hello, Kevin. Kevin.
Kevin, why is he saying?
Kevin. Kevin. Hello. Okay.
Talk at that volume.
It's so loud.
Can you hear me if I speak
awful.
Like this?
Finn sound kind of like I can hear him.
Okay, whatever. For now, that's fine. We'll pretend right. That's not.
Wait,
fun.
Julia, say something loudly.
Can you hear me if I talk like this loud? Or is it still...
Barely.
Barely? Oh. Okay, you know what? Barely is good enough.
Yeah, barely
okay,
is
I'll... Fine. Guys, if you're talking, lean into this, which will look weird, but it's fine because we're not going to use it.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, what I was going to say is, I think that a lot of the times, important call-outs stem from... Or a successful call-out. Stems from wanting to educate someone, not shame someone, which is a really key difference because a lot of times, like for example, the Dixie example that we use, people use shaming her sort of as a means to feel better about themselves. Like, look, I'm doing something important. I'm calling her out. We're canceling her. I'm part of something big. But that...
It takes away from... Sorry, finish your thought.
Yes. It's that isn't... I don't know. There's nothing to educate her on. There is nothing inherently wrong that happened that she needs room to grow and learn from. And a lot of the times as well, people don't even know the full story of what's happening. And this can be relevant in different ways depending on the situation. But for the example that we were using, apparently the whole thing was staged by her crew because they thought it would be entertaining.
Really?
And she lost like thousands of followers. Because everybody was using it as an outlet to sort of, like, altruistically make themselves feel like good people by shutting down something that isn't even worth, like, 1 ounce of energy.
And that's... It's kind of unfortunate how that sort of... It diverts attention away from sort of, not cancel culture, but issues of accountability that actually matter more. So I was going to say, like, do you think stuff like this, that pointless canceling of, like, influencers over the most pointless stuff, do you think that actually takes away from people being held accountable of other more important stuff?
Definitely I do. I think it diverts media attention and social media attention away from these really important issues. I've seen, like, Dixie lost so many more followers than, like, literal rapists have lost. It's upsetting. And I think with issues like this, it is a case of, like, when you are a young girl and when you have a platform like this and you get these privileges, people will...
Try to tear you down.
Exactly. They'll find any sort of outlet to try and disparage your success, which is...
Yeah.
That's unfortunate.
We've seen that so frequently that a lot of successful young girls, especially on social media platforms like TikTok and Instagram, they're, as soon as they rise to fame and start having some success, they're basically held under, like, a magnifying glass.
Yeah.
And every single thing that they do can now be wrong, when at the same time, there is hundreds of thousands of men on TikTok that are doing same or probably even worse, and people are turning a blind eye to it. Okay, so with all of this stuff that we've discussed in mind right now, who do you hope will see this book, and what message would you like them to take from it as a whole?
I think the target audience of the book is probably girls around aged 8 to 12, maybe a little older. I hope that people who are beginning to enter any sort of social media or online world will see it. I hope that they can use it as a bit of a toolbox, but also as some inspiration, because I think there are lots of places you can find the ways to be careful or the things that are bad about social media, because they are real. There are definitely very real dangers, but I hope that some young people can get a little bit excited or find some inspiration from the good things that are happening online as well.
Yeah, especially, like, you mentioned the dangers, and then in your book you included the social media, the safety tips,
mm-hmm.
which I thought was really cool. Because I could definitely see, like, a parent with their kid that they're going to, like, get them a phone for Christmas or something that would give them access to social media, buying them this book as, like, you know, something to read to safety. I think that would be a really cool thing.
Yes, buy the book.
Yeah, everyone, go buy the book, definitely. Yeah,
from,
yeah, it's like a big ad for the book. Okay.
Not sponsored.
Yeah, not sponsored by Better Connected, by Julia, who is sitting beside us right now.
We picked Julia to be here, not the other way around.
So, Julia, for the people who haven't read your book yet that are going to be listening to this podcast, is there, like, building off what Finn said, is there some key takeaways from the safety side of social media that you would maybe like to share?
Sure. I think with social media, it is definitely important to do your own research and not take everything you see online at face value. I think it's also important to be careful with who you trust and that kind of thing. I think there can also be a lot of dangerous people, especially when you're young. There's a lot of people who are looking to exploit you or sexualize you, and that can be scary. There's also a lot of good things you can do online when you're young. You can amplify other people's voices. You can use your social media as a platform for good, to spread the issues that you care about and amplify the people and the voices that you care about. So I hope that I can see more people in the future using social media as a platform for their advocacy as well.
Yeah, and on the other side of the same coin of social media, is there any tips that you have for young girls to get involved, or girls that maybe want to start a business or start some sort of page to spread awareness on social media that aren't really sure where to start, how they can use social media to create this impactful change? Do you have any sort of general takeaways or tips for those people?
Definitely. So to create change on social media, I think when you're young, it can be a bit difficult to make that large scale change, but I think it's important to think of, even if you have like a couple hundred followers or something like that, if you imagine those as a couple hundred real people who are listening to what you have to say, that is a lot more than what it seems like on the screen. So I think if you're young and looking to use social media for your advocacy, it can be a really good tool to translate that into real life activism as well. So if you're advertising initiatives that you're taking in real life on your social media to draw more people in, I think that can be a good way to do it. I think you can also utilize social media in more subtle ways, like normalizing putting pronouns in your bio or reposting things that you care about, amplifying marginalized or historically silenced voices. There's a lot of different little ways that you can do, and I would definitely say, like, couple that with real life actions and activism as well. But social media can be a good stepping stone, for sure.
Right. On the topic of activism, I believe in your book you mentioned slacktivism was the mm-hmm. term for it. I guess, what do you think, how do you think that takes away from, like, I know a while ago there was the Black Square Tuesday on Instagram.
Blackout Tuesday.
Blackout Tuesday. which a lot of people consider that to be incredibly performative for a lot of, especially celebrities. How do you think stuff like that is related to more real personal activism, like stuff you mentioned?
And do you also maybe want to define what slacktivism or performative activism is for the people who are listening and maybe aren't sure?
Sure. So I would say performative activism or slacktivism is putting on a front of activism to make yourself look good to others or to make yourself seem benevolent when you're not actually taking action or caring about those issues in your personal life or in your real life. It is definitely a big issue. I think it's a big thing I see in high school for sure, is when everyone is posting something or when an issue is trendy to care about, then everyone is going to hop onto that. But that is for sure problematic, because then the people being affected by these very real issues are not getting that real help that they need. And it's important to acknowledge the people that are actually experiencing these issues on the ground, in real life, offline. And a lot of the time I see people reposting these infographics to gain praise or to garner support, when in actuality I know that they don't support these issues. Like, you're posting about consent and then you're going to assault people at parties. Okay.
Do you think, because this is something I've seen, but I, now that you're talking about this, kind of makes me think about that. Do you think when it comes to performative activism versus true activism, women as a group are more sort of scrutinized or put under a microscope? For example, like when a guy might repost an infographic to his story, because we don't, at least I, through my social media, haven't seen that as much. He's very praised and respected, even if it is that type of performative activism. Whereas a woman, what might be doing the same and really putting like action to it, but then everybody's thinking, oh, she's just doing that to like look like she cares. Do you think there's sort of a discrepancy there?
Yeah, definitely. I think it is a double standard, because of course people can't see behind that screen and they can't really see into what you're doing in your real life. But there is that standard there, when I think it's more of an expectation for women to care about these issues than it is for men. And so when they do, then they gather a disproportionate amount of praise, when really you would hope that caring about general rights would be a standard.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very interesting, because I've never even thought about that until just now we started talking about it. It just goes to show how normalized it is, because the standard is so much higher, like we discussed earlier, for the group that is being marginalized to speak up for themselves, so that when someone else does it, they come in as this like hero, savior, even if it isn't actually
like that
what it seems. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Kevin, anything?
Anything to add to that, Kevin?
Well, I don't personally use that much of social media, so I'm unfortunately unaware really to the extent of this is a problem. I imagine that this kind of the performative activism and slacktivism serves to basically devalue a lot of important efforts that people are going through. Because then there is there's the assumption that, like the basic assumption, like turn into, oh, that's just performance activism or performative activism, whether it's an act of real thing. And it does sound like this is a problem for a woman specifically.
I think especially on social media like Instagram, you definitely see more girls posting and reposting those posts on activism and adding them to stories. And do you think that because girls do that more, when they do that, they're subjected to more judgment for it? Like, I feel like we mentioned how it's definitely easier to be seen if they're posting stuff like that, that's going to be performative activism. But do you think that actually, what's the word for it?
I really don't know.
I'm trying to think of what I'm trying to say. When they post on their stories, people are they, do you think they're going to receive more judgment for it, I suppose?
Yeah, definitely. I think girls are very much scrutinized in their activism, and you've got 14-year-old girls posting an infographic and then they're suddenly held to a standard where you can't make a mistake on what you know about activism, about feminism. I think, yeah, that was a big thing for me when I was younger and when I was just learning about feminism, is people are looking at you. They're looking at you to slip up or to make a mistake, and they're going to hold it above your head forever. And I think that's tricky when you're just a young person trying to learn about these things.
Yeah.
And that's on toxicity in social media.
Hi, I'm Kevin. I'm still recovering from a bout of COVID, so I will be speaking
a
voice from the boy, as it were.
Kevin, sorry, just like so that we can edit this easier, we should like pause for like 2 seconds or something so we have a little bit of leeway versus...
Yeah, okay. Let's have silence for 2 seconds and then Kevin re-say that and then let's all be silent for 2 seconds.
Yeah, yeah. So Kevin, just like wait a second and then say it.
Go!
I'm Kevin and I'm recovering from a bit of COVID, so I will be joining on a voice from the void, as it were.
Awesome. Okay.
Perfect.
Okay, one thing that I think we should have started with is to ask... Okay, I'm just going to ask it. Because we immediately started with the book and no one has read the book except for us. Which is good, but I think we should start with...
Should we talk about the book more?
I think we've talked about the book quite a bit. I mean, we can... I think we should do
yes.
a section. You can, like, look through this if you want because I don't want to spring it on you.
That's
but
so
if we, I ask you a question, like... Is there a particular story of one of the girls that you discussed in the book that you would like to share with everyone that's, like, really inspiring or something like that?
Oh, hold on.
Okay, yeah, you don't have to find it. But I think that we should start off by saying, like, can you tell us a bit about how you got into the realm of feminism and where that journey has led to now? Because then she can, like, talk about herself, like, right at the start, but also, like, talk about how she got into it, which could be good. And then you... Wait, there's no rush. Kat, is there anything else we want to talk about specifically? That's a clue. Did we ask her to share some resources for individual... We can do those too.
Right, and then...
But let's... Between these, let's just take pauses after she's done answering so we can put them in wherever we want.
Right.
Okay.
Kevin, is there anything you want to ask after these two that I have highlighted?
Okay, sure.
Yeah. Do you have a time limit? This shouldn't go on for too much longer.
Really,
no, I'm good.
I'm
going
on translating.
I just don't
want to
like keep you for
a
minute.
Yeah, it shouldn't be too much longer. I mean, we've talked for like an hour.
I'm not in a rush. It's all good.
Awesome.
Okay. One sec. Okay, I'm gonna start off with first. Do you want to do this one first or?
I don't care. You can do either. Whatever.
Okay. Let's just do this.
Okay. Sure.
Okay. So. In your book, you discussed a lot of stories of women who took to social media and lots of different ways that they were able to create change just through starting something by advertising or creating it on a social media platform. So is there a specific story of a girl that you found while you were researching for this book that you want to share with everyone that maybe really inspired you?
Sure. I was really inspired by the story of Helena Gualinga, and she is an indigenous girl from Ecuador. And reading about her story was really interesting to me because she was able to advocate for the resources that she needed and to protect the forests that her family was indigenous to through social media. And she was able to reach platforms like the United Nations through that advocacy. And I think that was a good example of how social media can be a powerful tool, because when you're in a rural community like that, or when you're not necessarily in the main eye of the media, it can be difficult to have that platform for advocacy, and social media allowed her to gain that platform and share her story. So that was interesting for me.
Yeah, that's really inspiring that there's so many different ways from anyone basically around the world to get involved.
That's
great.
And that's, you know, that's the good parts of social media, like your book talks about, which, you know, I'm interested in mostly. So Julia, do you have any resources that you'd be willing to share with us for people who want to get into advocacy for feminism, but like aren't sure where to begin?
Sure, I definitely do. So I think consuming feminist media is a good start. So whether that be books or movies or TV or who you follow on social media, that can be a good way to start to learn and also to unlearn the things that you've been taught. So I really recommend Mona Al-Tahawi's books. Mm-hmm. I love them. I love The Seven Necessary Sins. I also really love Against White Feminism by Rafia Zakaria. That's a good one to start with. I think also just donating your time or donating your money, either of those things, to causes that you care about, or taking initiative on any level or any scale, whether that's in your school or community. And then I think feminism can also be as much of an internal kind of battle as it is an external one. Mm-hmm. So also taking the time to learn and unlearn all the things you've been taught, whether that's like things about beauty or about sex or passivity, just trying to undo those things that get really ingrained in your mind.
Yeah, I think the concept of unlearning is something that is really interesting, because I think it's equally as important as learning is, because you never really realize until you start sort of unlearning that in your mind how much you've been taught, whether it be through the media or just through how society teaches and helps grow up, foster young women. Like, for example, I have a sister. She's 7 years old now, and it's really interesting for me to observe how she's growing up and how having me along the way sort of unteach her things that I never even realized we were taught from such a young age is something so important. Like, I remember a while ago, you never really realize how much of these negative things you're taught in the media. A while ago, she came up to me and she told me, "I hate the color pink." And I said, "Why?" And she said, "Pink is for girls." But I said, "You are a girl." And that's so interesting to me, because from young, we're immediately taught anything associated with being a girl is bad. Being a girl is bad. You should be more like a guy to be cool. And I think that one of the biggest principles in achieving true feminism isn't saying, like, you, all women should be like this and do stuff like this to be able to have feminism. Not like that. I think it should be autonomy is the most important thing, that a woman is able to do what she wants and become what she wants without facing the scrutiny and the stereotypes that society teaches and enforces throughout your whole life, basically.
Yeah.
Definitely. I think the example you're talking about with your sister is a really common thread of, like, the beginnings of internalized misogyny. And I think that's something I've been pondering a lot recently. We were talking about it in Feminism Club last week. But internalized misogyny is so, so harmful. It's part of the big, larger web of misogyny. And I think it's also always viewed as kind of a phase. Like, on TikTok, they call it the pick-me-girl phase, I guess, where you grow out of it eventually. But I don't even think that's true. I honestly think you never grow out of it after society gets that into your head. So it really takes that time of trying to actively undo these ideas that have been stuck in your mind about what femininity is or what girlhood or womanhood is to figure out your own journey with that.
Mm-hmm. What else would you want to say? Can I take some photos with your phone?
So yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Where is it?
In my pocket. Here.
Okay.
I have, just going back to when you're talking about intersectionality a little bit ago, what do you think intersectionality within feminism looks like within our community? Because in your book, you talk about it on the big picture, sort of online more. What do you think that looks like, I suppose, within, like, our school or our community within Vancouver?
Sure. I am a firm believer in, if your feminism isn't intersectional, it's not feminism, for sure. I think something that's really common is trans exclusionary feminism, or just subtle racism within feminism as well. I think that since writing this book, I've learned a lot about white feminism and how that manifests as well. And that's been interesting to me, seeing the lack of intersectionality that has existed throughout the whole feminist movement.
Right.
And I think trying to learn to be an intersectional feminist as a high school student, you just really have to be open to hearing new voices and perspectives and not speaking over others who have that lived experience. Because
right.
if you have work experience or
yeah.
you have research experience, it's never going to be the same. So...
Mm-hmm.
And then I think also as like as someone discovering your own intersections, that's interesting as well. You've got to kind of learn to be more comfortable with them and learn how they overlap. Like for me, being biracial and being a woman, it's been interesting to kind of learn where those identities intersect and figure out that as well throughout high school.
Yeah, for sure. How do you think we can be conscious about whether feminism we're practicing is intersectional or not? Do you think there's, you know, stuff that we can sort of recognize as it happens and go like, hey, this isn't what it should be?
Yeah, for sure. I think a lot of the time, making sure you know where the terms you're using come from, things like that, that's something that I've been learning lately. Is I've stopped referring to feminism in waves because I learned that that was actually of white feminist origin. And I think also just being open to hearing new voices and perspectives and holding yourself accountable or letting others hold you accountable if you make a mistake and learning from that. And I think if you find yourself getting really defensive over something like that, or especially if you are in a place of privilege in these situations, or if you're a man, then that's probably a sign that you should take a step back and think
right.
it over a bit.
Reevaluate, yeah.
So, Julia, when you're speaking of these so-called waves of feminism, what do they pertain to? For our future waves, what will they look like?
Sure, yeah. So I'm definitely trying to deconstruct those terms of waves now, because what I've been learning is that women of color really did start a lot of these movements before white women overtook it. So that's why I don't really use those terms anymore. But I think as feminism moves forward and as it kind of gains more traction, it will definitely become increasingly online. But I hope that in the next stages of feminism, people can learn how to translate that online advocacy into real life action as well, because I think that's the disconnect that we're currently seeing in this stage of feminism, is there's online feminism, there's real life activism, and there's a bit of a disconnect between them.
Right. So Julia, if you had one message about everything we've talked about that you wanted to tell the viewers, what would it be?
I would say the main takeaway that I hope people have is just to go further with your feminism. I think something that I see so often is people get up to a certain point and then they kind of hit a wall of, oh, I don't want to make anyone upset, or I don't want to step beyond this line that I've drawn for myself. And I hope that people can kind of move past that, be a little more radical, try and make some real life change, and just question the things that society has taught you and try actively to unlearn that misogyny and empower those around you.
Right. Thank you.
That's very well said. I feel like we covered a lot of really good topics today within the realm of social media and the media in general, connected to your book, Better Connected. So thank you so much for coming here today with us, Julia. It was really, really great to talk with you about this. I hope that our listeners can draw something from this and really understand that anyone can make a change, and it's something for all of us to be doing. It's not just on one person or one group of people.
Yeah, for sure. Again, thank you so much for coming. This was awesome.
Yeah, thank you, Julia.
Thank you, Julia, for coming. And also, sorry for like being here, but big moments of kind of your format. So thanks for talking with us here.
Yes, Kevin will be joining us live next week. So hopefully we won't have
Mm-hmm.
We won't have the audio issues.
Well,
Well, thank you guys so much for having me, and thank you all for listening.
Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning in. A big thank you again to Julia for having this great discussion with us. We hope to see you all next week on the very new episode of the Perspective Podcast.